The Philippine National Police Anti-Cybercrime Group in hot water for alleged lapses in last month's raid at a POGO hub in Las Piñas City. Mike Navalio has the details.
It was the Philippine National Police Anti-Cybercrime Group's biggest raid of the year. More than 2,000 alleged human trafficking victims rescued from a POGO compound in Las Piñas with a substantial number of varying nationalities. But it's turning out to be too good to be true. Aside from earlier allegations of torture at the hands of authorities, no less than the Justice Secretary himself is now saying the operation did not comply with protocols and did not coordinate with the DOJ's Interagency Council Against Trafficking.
Walang specific grounds para hulihin ng tao. Walang specific complainants ng maraming tao. Basta raid lang, raid. Ganun. Pumasok na sila. Para nanging isda. Manghuhuli ka na walang kaso. Ano, magtatanim ka ng kaso? Hindi pwede sa DOJ, hindi kami papayag dyan. Kaya ngayon, nagkakaproblema sila.
The raid took place on the same day that the DOJ and the PNP started training law enforcers on a new department circular that mandates prosecutors to take a more active role in case buildup. Human trafficking is among the cases where coordination between prosecutors and law enforcers is required.
May pag-uusap na kasi ang DOJ at saka yung anti-cybercrime group ng PNP na bago kumilos ay mag-case build-up muna para pag tayo ay nag-raid at tayo ay manghuli, ang lahat ng ating huhulihin ay pihadong may ebidensya laban sa kanila. Hindi po ito naging nasunod, tumuloy po sila at ngayon marami hong nakabinbin na hindi ma-file na kaso sapagkat wala namang ebidensya na kompleto.
The PNP, however, stood by its operation, insisting there was prior coordination.
On the part of PNP Anti-Cybercrime Group, according to them, they have done the necessary coordination with Interagency Council Against Trafficking. And in fact, prosecutors were present during the initial stages of the implementation of search warrant. And this Interagency Council Against Trafficking, the head of that council is the Department of Justice.
But it admitted, however, to facing challenges in bringing the charges in court when initial witnesses later on became reluctant to sign any affidavit.
There were complainants actually that who came forward and provided information. That were the basis why the PNP ACG applied for search warrant. And the proof of the mere fact that these search warrants were issued by the concerned regional trial court would only prove that there was indeed a probable cause for the case of human trafficking.
And in yet another criticism of the operation, Senator Rafi Tulfo now alleging anomalous transactions between the PNP ACG and the respective embassies of foreign nationals involving sums of money exchanged for the release of their citizens.
Nagkakaroon po ng tawaran. I'm serious about this and I have proof, but right now, hindi ko po pwede i-divulge yan, na yung mga foreigners na nandoon, hinihingian ng pera bago sila pakawalan at i-repatriate. Yung mga local na mga Chinese na nandoon, hinihingian ng pera bago sila pakawalan at papalabasin na victim. Even doon sa mga Pilipino, hinihingian para palabasin silang victim. Ginagawa lang gatasan.
The PNP has yet to comment on this issue. The lawyer of the five Chinese suspects said he has no knowledge of the scheme, but he acknowledged the possibility. And despite Rimulya's statement that the five Chinese suspects have been released to undergo further probe, attorney Christian Vargas said his clients are still being detained in the compound. According to Vargas, a panel of prosecutors issued a release order dated July 3 that was received by the PNP ACG on July 4.
The PNP is overstaying already inside the compound, no? Why did I say that? Kasi ang search warrant, yung mga search warrant, those were issued last June 26, 2023. Mm-hmm. It is now July 10, 2023.
Of the more than 2,000 individuals rescued, around 1,100 are still in the Las Piñas POGO facility. The Filipinos were allowed to go home, but the foreigners without visas were already sent home. Foreigners with visas, however, will still have to go through visa cancellation proceedings.
Moving forward, we will be filing a case in court already to get the custody of this foreigners, no, na magiging ang mga kliyente natin.
Mm-hmm.
At para makalaya na rin sila doon sa loob, kasi para talagang kulungan na ho yung loob ng Hong Kong compound.
Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Customs Bureau now monitoring a hub of luxury cars in Pasig City due to questionable documents. In a raid conducted last July 4, the BOC discovered 197 foreign and locally sourced vehicles at the dealership, and 87 of them had questionable paperwork. A 100% inventory of the vehicles was immediately conducted. Among the high-end car brands found were Lexus, Mercedes-Benz, Porsche, and Lamborghini. The car dealer has 15 days after the raid to submit evidence of payment of correct duties and taxes. Otherwise, these vehicles will be seized and will undergo corresponding for future proceedings. Finance Chief Benjamin Jokno hopes the merger of state-owned Land Bank of the Philippines and the Development Bank of the Philippines will be complete by the middle of next year. Jokno shares his office has already submitted to the Office of the President a draft executive order for the proposed merger that will create the country's largest bank with an asset of 4.2 trillion pesos. The merger is expected to save for government some 5 billion every year. And under the proposal, Land Bank will be the surviving entity and only 22 of the 147 DBP branches will be retained. Now, more on the country's trade data. The trade gap narrowed further in May to $4.4 billion. This is exports increased while imports fell. Total export sales hit $6.4 billion, a nearly 2% increase from a year ago on the back of higher shipment of electronics. Imports, meanwhile, fell 8.8% to $10.8 billion, dragged by lower shipments in mineral fuels, lubricants, and related materials. According to the Philippine Statistics Authority, China was the country's biggest supplier of imported goods, as well as the top export trading partner of the country for the month of May. The agency also noted the country's total external trade for the month posted an annual decline of 5.1% to $17.3 billion. The timetable for the opening of Metro Manila's subway is pushed back by 2 years to 2029. Jackie Manabat gives us a look at the subway tunnel's construction work that has begun.
Billed as the project of the century, the construction of the Metro Manila subway project is on track as the Department of Transportation aims to open the first subway in the country by 2029. However, the agency scrapped its initial plan to operate the subway partially in 2027. Instead, the Department of Transportation will open the subway with all its 17 stations in 2029 or 6 years from now.
We are not looking into the partial operability of 2027. Ang target na natin is full operations by 2029. Kasi kung magpa-partial operability tayo hanggang a certain station, hindi naman natin siya, parang hindi siya optimized, no, for our passengers, di ba? So it would be best na we just operate it pagka buo na.
The officials invited the press for a tour of the construction of the Valenzuela Depot Monday morning. They said that the 33-kilometer underground railway is 33% complete when it comes to civil works. They have yet to address the right-of-way issues, mostly in Valenzuela City. Once opened in 2029, it is expected to accommodate an estimate of 519,000 passengers daily from Valenzuela Station to NAIA Terminal 3 and FTI in Taguig. The subway will also be interconnected with other rail lines, such as the future North-South Commuter Railway Station in Taguig. The proposed fare for the subway is 22 pesos for the boarding fee and a distance fare of 2 pesos per kilometer, which means that the end-to-end fare will be 88 pesos. However, the DOTR said this is not yet the final fare, as they have added 4 more stations and they have yet to consider the slowdown of construction brought about by the impact of the pandemic. Originally estimated to cost 350 billion, the project's total cost was raised to 488 billion pesos. The joint venture, including Shimizu Corporation, Fujita Corporation, and Takenaka Civil Engineering of Japan, and EEI Corporation from the Philippines were tapped to design and build a depot in Valenzuela City, Quezon Highway Station, Tandangsora Station, and North Avenue Station. The Metro Manila Subway will leverage Japanese technology to make the structure flood and earthquake-proof.
Our Japan design team designed the subway similar to Japan. It is elevated. There is even a simulation exercise where water cannot pass through from outside. Kasi meron siyang, yung entry natin siya ay maliit lang. Tapos meron siyang gate doon. Sarado yun. Airtight yung gate doon. Kapag ka may tubig, kapag mabaha. Pero hindi tayo babahain sapagkat elevated ang gate natin.
From Valenzuela, the excavation will run for a kilometer and a half to reach the next station, Quirino Station in Novaliches. The tunnel boring machine, also manufactured in Japan, will lay down 8 to 10 meters of tunnel segments per day, excavating around 300 to 400 meters of soil in the same time frame. The subway station is expected to ease traffic congestion in Metro Manila. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
A group of companies from the United States reaffirmed their commitment to boost cooperation and investment in the Philippines. Members of the Business Executives for National Security met with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Monday. On the agenda, business opportunities in health, digital infrastructure, and energy. Marcos said the country will soon launch a multi-specialty hospital outside Manila in order to bring healthcare down to the grassroots level. The president also assured the group his administration will address concerns of American business executives regarding the price, reliability, and supply of energy, as well as the ease of doing business in the country. Marcos also reiterating the government's commitment to boost digital infrastructure. China's first ever personal bankruptcy case has turned his life around sooner than expected. After his business failed, Shenzhen resident Mr. Liang filed for personal bankruptcy in March 2021, the same month that the landmark regulation came into effect in the city. In the restructuring plan he submitted, he promised to pay back his debt each month, while his wife paid for household expenses. The court appointed a law firm as his bankruptcy administrator and required him to pay and repay all of his principal debt amounting to 600,000 yuan in 3 years. That's nearly four million pesos in peso terms. Mr. Liang proved to be a successful test case, managing to pay off his debt, get this, 15 months earlier than the court's deadline.